Michael Elias is an award-winning writer, actor, and director who has written film, television, theater, and fiction. He is best known for his socially conscious and highly entertaining film and television work. Michael was born and raised in upstate New York, moving to New York City after graduating from St. John's College in Annapolis to pursue a career in acting. He transitioned to Hollywood and with Frank Shaw, Zichrono Livracha, wrote the screenplay for 1979's The Frisco Kid, starring Gene Wilder and Harrison Ford, the subject of today's talk. Michael also worked with Steve Martin, as you see, a collaboration that included material for Martin's comedy albums, network TV specials, and the screenplay for The Jerk, 1979, another favorite. This is just, to me, an interesting alternative title for the film. This is from the Spanish language release of The Frisco Kid, El Rabino y el Pistolero, The Rabbi and the Gunslinger, which probably is a more appropriate title. And we might talk about the title changes for the film as well. I don't want to spoil that, but it says up at the top as well, together the rabbi and the gunslinger blazed a new trail into the Wild West. Michael had a long writing partnership with screenwriter Rich Eustace. Among other things, they created Head of the Class, a television series for ABC that ran from 1986 to 1991. This fondly remembered sitcom, a favorite of mine growing up, was partially based on Michael's experience as a high school teacher in New York City. Michael wrote and directed Showtime's Lush Life from 1993 with Forrest Whitaker and Jeff Goldblum. He was nominated for Best Director at the Cable Ace Awards that year. And this TV movie has become something of a jazz film classic. You also see his semi-autobiographical play about a small hotel in upstate New York titled The Catskill Sonata, which ran for 4 months in Los Angeles in 2007. The LA Weekly called it one of the best 10 plays of that year. Lately, Michael is a novelist, and he'll tell us maybe a little bit more about that as we progress. But Michael's novel, You Can Go Home Now, published by HarperCollins in 2020, is a timely and addictive psychological thriller featuring a female cop on the hunt for a killer while battling violent secrets of her own. Now, to set the tone and the mood and the theme and everything else for today's interview conversation, I want to play a scene from The Frisco Kid. I'm assuming that all of us have seen it, or most of us, many of us, at least at some point in our lives. Most of us, many of us, all of us are probably pretty fond of the film as well. And this scene to me is quite pertinent to not only the real underlying core of the movie, the message of the movie, but I think will play into our conversation today also. So here we have Tommy the cowboy, played by Harrison Ford. He's just robbed a bank, much to the disappointment of his writing companion, Rabbi Avram Belinsky, played by Gene Wilder. They are fleeing from a posse, but it is Shabbat, and Rabbi Avram refuses to ride on his horse. The halachic compromise you'll see the rabbi make in this scene is what's at the core of the film, which follows a Polish-born rabbi who arrives in Philadelphia in 1850 and takes an overland trek to San Francisco, along the way adapting his old world Jewish identity to the strange new open landscape and eventually transforming into an American rabbi.
They shane in veirananimi.
Not ready.
Lehagid ki yosho tsuri yovlo so boy.
Church over. We better make tracks. I figure they know pretty much where we're at. Ain't gonna take them too long to find us.
Hold still. Hold still, Halsey. Be good.
Can't really afford such a late start. What the hell are you doing?
I don't ride today.
What are you talking about?
Today is Saturday.
So?
I don't ride on Saturday.
Well, I know that, but don't tell me you ain't gonna ride today.
I ain't gonna ride today.
I asked you not to tell me that.
That's what I'm telling you.
But this ain't no ordinary Saturday.
Why is this Saturday different from all other Saturdays?
'Cause this Saturday, there's a hanging posse chasing us. I promise you, right now, they're doubling back to that stream.
I don't ride on Saturday.
Jesus, you give me the pea doodles. There ain't no Jews in that posse, you know? They'd as soon string you up on Saturday as any other day. God damn it if I'm gonna walk.
I've asked you not to say that.
You stupid, ignorant son of a bitch! I ain't waiting around for that posse to find us. I'm leaving.
Who's asking you to stay?
Goodbye. Ha! Ha!
Ha! There it is.
I'm gonna show you something. Look over there.
You know what that is?
Yes.
Well?
When the sun sets.
You know what you are? You're real Meshuguna.
A sugar now.
They're coming. Damn you. They're coming. Now.
Not yet.
Now.
Not yet.
Now!
Scene. So before we get into other matters, I just want to note that, you know, instead of waiting for the three stars to appear in the sky for Shabbat to end, there was this moment where, thinking on his toes, Rabbi Avram decides, okay, something's gotta happen, you know, with the universe here in order for me to feel comfortable that Shabbat is over. But it's not really over. And I wonder, Michael, if that was, in your mind, as big a turning point in the film as it is through my eyes, just watching this movie, knowing that the real intention is to show that this rabbi is adapting to America, sort of needing to make these little compromises along the way.
Yes, obviously it's not quite evening. So for life and death, and I think he has to make that decision. He's not suicidal. At the same time, he holds on as long as he can, and I think the point is made. But your larger point is that, and that was really on purpose in the writing of the film, to show. Sorry, I thought I the transition of an European. Hello.
I think you're good now.
I am. I don't see me. I'm going to launch meeting again. See what happens here. That's my. Okay. Can you see me?
Yes, no, we can.
Oh, okay. I don't see anybody. I don't see you. But I'll keep talking until it comes back. That the Odyssey from Poland to San Francisco and across America is the it's kind of the Americanization of a rabbi, and certain, and I don't mean this in a pejorative sense, certain baggage has to be discarded in terms of the realities of being a pioneer and making one's way across the country. And I suppose that's a kind of a comic illustration of it. There probably are others in the film or the screenplays. So, yeah, the scene. It does work, and he's the exasperation of Tommy confronted with this rabbi who's strict and he won't ride on the Sabbath. That's a rule. You can't.
Right.
You can run. You can run on the Sabbath, but you can't ride.
So that brings up another, I think, larger point as well. I alluded to it already. But the desire to make a historically accurate yet entertaining film, which I know you and I have talked about before, you know, there was a lot in the archival documents, diaries and so forth of real Jews who made real treks, a very similar path that the rabbi's making in this film, from the, you know, coming from Europe to the East Coast to eventually the Western states. And along the way, writing in their diaries, well, I just had, you know, my first taste of pork because there was nothing else to eat and I'm still alive, you know, and basically talking about these kinds of changes that they have to make along the way. And I know that when I spoke with you, one of the reasons I reached out to you is that you credit the journal, the Western States Jewish History Journal, that has been published for over 50 years now, with inspiring some of the vignettes in your film and kind of getting the idea of the landscape for the movie. And you also mentioned that you grew up in upstate New York and didn't have much of a connection to the West. So I'm just wondering what the film was for you on more of a autobiographical level, if that makes sense. You know, why did you write it? What was the purpose?
Well, first of all, about the Western States Jewish Historical Journal, there would be no Frisco Kid without it, that's for sure. And I don't know how I found it. I don't know. I can't remember whether, and I can't remember. I probably had the idea to make the film first and then did research and found the journal. And then it was like, it just was Aladdin's cave. I mean, this was fantastic. Here were all these first person accounts of Jews, pioneer Jews in the Old West. And it was, aside from being inspirational, it was informational. The original, we all want to see ourselves in film. And television, and growing up in the 50s, 60, whatever, as a Jewish. I didn't see, I certainly didn't see Jews in the Old West, which means cowboy movies, which was our, you know, growing up was our staple. And every one of, I loved cowboy movies. I went religiously, and John Wayne and Roy Rogers and Gene Autry and all of those people, I love them. And I never saw a Jew in the movie. So in, there were Jews in movies, but they were pawnbrokers, they were lawyers, they were bankers, they were not, or they were, you know, entertainers too. But that whole fantasy life for us was cowboys. We played cowboys. We dressed as cowboys. We listened to cowboy music. By the way, I just want to say, growing up in the Catskills, which was incredibly Jewish in the summer, you know, that was the Jewish resort from June to September. I was immersed in New York Jewish population. But as I said, I didn't see myself in the movies. And then as a result, I think I began to think of myself as an other. And combined with Israel and the formation of the state and everything that we learned and loved about Israel, and I think consciously, at least in synagogue and through whatever, we were kind of told that. I mean, one thing, because post-war and the Holocaust, was that we would, as Jews, we would always have a place to go, which was Israel, in the event that America became anti-Semitic and or whatever, our lives were in danger. So there was a combination of two things. One is an identification of our being with Israel as our real home. And the other one was exclusion in our culture of portraying us as Americans. So that I think the combination resulted in almost this subconscious perception that not all, but some American Jews were, that they weren't completely American. We were kind of second-class Americans. And the responsibility for that rests, it's spread out. Okay. And I'm not the blame. So when I was in Hollywood, came to Hollywood, I guess sitting around with Frank Shaw, and we were discussing this and how, and here we were in the Wild West. We were in California. We were in Hollywood. And we said, how come there's no Jews and, you know, cowboys, or the cow, where they're West, you know, Jews came West. And so we started saying, let's make a movie. Let's make a cowboy movie, a Western, with a Jewish hero. That was it. And we said, okay. And then the research followed and so forth. And then we said, who can be the most Jewish hero? Well, he's got to be a rabbi. Okay, how did rabbis get here? Right? They didn't all come in 1927 or 1950. They came here. They had to have come. We knew, I mean, we're completely ignorant. We knew about Levi Strauss. We knew about San Francisco, Jews in San Francisco. And then combining that with discovering the Jewish Journal, the Western States Journal, it all sort of fell into place. And we said, okay, we will write a movie about a rabbi who comes from, young rabbi who comes from Poland and has to make his way across America, and we'll make it kind of like a Western. But what we want to show is that there were Jews in the Old West who were pioneer Jews, and we're here just as much as anybody else. Okay. And as a matter of fact, what we also learned, I mean, we learned a lot of wonderful things about pioneer Jews, which we tried to put in the movie, which was, they were not the enemies of the Indians because they had no interest in converting them. they also or selling the liquor or stealing their land and so forth. So that was something. There were a lot of things to be proud of. Mm-hmm. And then we discovered all these kind of interesting characters like Solomon Beeple, who was a chief of the Acoma Pueblo in New Mexico. And I can't remember his name, who was this famous champion shot. He was a great marksman and bigger than Annie Oakley, and he was famous, and so forth and so on. And then the Jews of Oakland and the Gertrude Stein family and so forth. And then the population of the Jewish border towns and the gold Goldwater family. Anyway, it's too rich and it's too exhaustive. I mean, it's great. So we're writing the movie, but I just want to make it clear that we did not set out to make a comedy. We set out to make a serious movie about a dogmatic provincial rabbi from a shtetl in Poland who makes his way across the country and ends up being a rabbi in San Francisco, and becomes Americanized to a certain degree along the way and faces the conflicts. And of course, it would be amusing. There would be parts that would be amusing, and there were parts that would be heartbreaking. And he would bring with him the trauma and the of the pogroms and the anti-Semitism and the fact of being an immigrant. And in that, because that's the journey my grandfather and Frank's grandfather and grandmother had in the early 20th century. It's the same. I will just point out one little thing, that when people came to America at that time, they did not cross the country to go to San Francisco. They took a boat to Nicaragua or El Salvador, and went across the there was no Panama Canal, but they walked across and then took a boat to San Francisco. So they did not, most people who ended up in San Francisco, that's the way they went, and it was a much easier journey. It was by sea, and then you walk 20 miles, and then it was by sea again. Okay, so.
Right, and you know, I did some calculations along those lines, because there were, you know, some who took trains across the, and wagon trains also, mm-hmm. across the continent, and you know, part of me wonders how long this journey must have been, right? Because it would have been months, really, from getting from Philadelphia to San Francisco, and the kinds of transformation personally that the rabbi would have made along the way probably would have been quite profound. I think one of the nice things about the movie, and particularly the original screenplay, is that from my perspective, you're really using Rabbi Avram, Gene Wilder's character, as kind of a vehicle to tell a lot of different stories, because he does encounter Native Americans. He does bring a Torah to San Francisco at the time that the first Torah was actually recorded being brought to San Francisco. I doubt that was a coincidence, but you had him doing it instead of the historical personages who did that. So, I mean, that to me is really fascinating, the episodic kind of nature of the movie, that you can see him as kind of the stand-in for a lot of different kinds of Jews who did settle and did migrate in through different places. So I have two actually different questions, and you can answer them one at a time. The first is, I remember reading that John Wayne was considered for the role of Tommy, and that Harrison Ford was kind of just a second choice or something like that. And related to that, Gene Wilder, when he heard that John Wayne might be playing that character, he was kind of relieved, because Gene, for his own reasons, didn't want the movie to be perceived as a Jewish movie. Is this all factual?
I can go back a little further. Sure. The original It went to this producer, Mace Neufeld, through our agent, Bernie Weintraub. And Mace Neufeld gave it to Buck Henry, who writer and actor. And Buck Henry's best friend was Mike Nichols. He gave it to Mike Nichols, and Mike Nichols said, I want to direct this movie. Mike Nichols gave it to Jack Nicholson to play the cowboy, and he gave it to Dustin Hoffman to play the rabbi. That was the original cast. And like all things in Hollywood, it fell apart. And then it kind of went to other directors, and a couple of years later, it ended up, Warner Brothers, and it went to John Wayne. And John Wayne had a price for a movie. He got $750,000. Sounds little these days, but that's what that was his price. And some idiot at Warner Brothers in business affairs offered him $600,000, and he hung up on him and said, never talk to me again about, you know, from Warner Brothers or this movie. So there went John Wayne. Then it went, it was around, but I mean, and then Gene Wilder. And Gene Wilder made it happen. I own everything. Because when he said yes, then they hired a director, Robert Aldrich, who is a great director and a wonderful guy, and exactly the wrong person to direct this movie. And you talk about that in your paper, and you're absolutely right. He was a terrific, hard-boiled director who didn't really have a flair for comedy, and also didn't have a flair or an understanding of the immigrant experience and the and what that entailed. So the movie How Harrison Ford. I think Harrison was probably the next best choice after John Wayne, and that's how we didn't get John Wayne and how we got Harrison Ford.
Yeah, very interesting. Okay. Yeah. You know, a follow-up to that. I noticed that in more recent releases of the film on DVD, even some VHS releases as well, Harrison Ford's picture is much bigger than Gene Wilder's. I'm assuming that's because of Star Wars and Indiana Jones and all the popularity around that. But it's kind of funny because the way that you described it to me is that Gene Wilder really took hold of the movie and made it, in some sense, in his own image. You know, we don't have to speak ill of the dead or anything like that, but I know that some of your vision collided with Gene Wilder's vision, and he was a big star at that time. Yeah. And, you know, he had a lot of power and a lot of say in what stayed in and what was cut out and how certain scenes were shot. I don't know if you want to comment on
any of that. Gene, first of all, Gene saw it as a comedy, and took every opportunity to make it funnier than to make it find places where he could make it funny, and sometimes at the expense of the theme or the intent of the movie. And I can give examples, but and they're in your paper when you found them because. They're there. And if you look at the film and if you look at the original screenplay, the other thing is, and I think this was a battle, internal battle, is Gene saw it as, well, I will tell you at one point when he wanted to have a shootout, something real, a real shootout, he said at the end, you know, this is a cowboy movie and the hero has to shoot it out with the bad guys. And I said, Gene, they didn't send for a gunslinger. They sent for a rabbi. And I think maybe that got to him for a second because that adjusted that last scene where he can't shoot the guy. But that's how he saw it. He saw himself in a traditional cowboy movie. Right. Part of it was his traditional cowboy movie, and it had to follow those rules. What the movie is an odyssey. I mean, I'm taking away and an odyssey is a journey of the hero to some place where people are waiting for him. That's what's important. Ulysses is trying to get home, but at home, Penelope is waiting for him because the suitors are eating her out of house and home and wanting to marry her and so forth. He doesn't know how badly they need him. He just wants to get home. And the rabbi doesn't know how the San Francisco community needs him because they're starting to fall apart. So that's not a Western, that's not the schema of a Western film. A Western film is to find the bad guys and kill them, you know, restore justice, whatever it is. But that's, or personal thing, that's it. And Wilder, Gene, he didn't see that. He didn't get that part. And yes, it's true. And it's true that, it was the combination of, positionally weak director, producer, and an enormously powerful star. And at the end, there was Aldrich came to me and he said, look, we have a problem with the ending. And Gene wrote an ending, which was a Gary Cooper shootout, you know. And he said, and bless Aldrich. Aldrich said, Gene wrote an ending, I won't shoot it. And I wrote an ending and Gene won't act in it. And he won't act. No, I'm sorry. Gene wrote an ending. I won't shoot it. You guys wrote an ending. Gene won't act in it. If I write the ending, Gene might do it. But I'm not a writer. So will you write the ending and say that I wrote it? And we said, yes. And that's how it happened. So that's how you had to deal with these guys, with these egomaniacal, movie stars. And he's not the first and he won't be the last. And yes, the irony is that Harrison Ford went on to become a much bigger star, and Harrison Ford was a junior partner in this movie. We wrote a beautiful scene where Harrison and Gene end up in a miners' camp, in a cabin, a big cabin, and there are all these gold miners there, and at one point. A miner gets up and reads a letter from his wife, and all the miners cry because they're all sad about it. And Gene said, well, you can't have that in the film. He said, why not? He says, well, I can't follow that. And Aldrich said, Gene, this is not vaudeville. Anyway,
I hear what you're...
And now I just want to add one more thing. Occasionally, there would be stuff that Gene would take out of the script that was good for Harrison. And Harrison he didn't have the juice to say no. Now, of course, it's reversed. And poor Gene is dead, so he can't argue against me. Anyway.
Well, and you mentioned vaudeville. That's something else I was going to ask about because, you know, growing up in the Catskills and, you know, having some, I'm sure... I know exposure to the kind of traveling entertainers and such that would frequent such places. In the early days of vaudeville, you know, the late 19th century, there was a kind of running gag amongst the what were called stage Jew performers. These were often Jews themselves who kind of made fun of Jews. It's sort of like blackface, but Jew face, actually. And you can certainly look into that. It's very interesting. But a lot of that was immigrant performers basically trying to distance themselves from the old world and to say, that's what we used to be like. We're becoming Americans. Weren't we funny? Aren't our parents and our grandparents silly? That kind of thing. I'm kind of minimizing that phenomenon. But nevertheless, there was a sub-genre of Jew face, which was actually the cowboy Jew, who would try to go west, kind of fail miserably as a gunslinger, come back home if they survived, you know, head hanging low and all of that kind of thing. And the idea from the New York Jewish perspective was you can't be a cowboy. You can't really be a Westerner. You just have to kind of embrace who you are and work within those constraints. And it's interesting when you mention that Gene Wilder wanted the rabbi to be a gunslinger, because there is that whole kind of vaudevillian slapstick humor around the immigrant Jew who wants to be a gunslinger and basically failing at it. And I saw a bit of that, and this might have not been intentional on your part, but in the scene where towards the end, Gene Wilder, Avram, is bringing the Torah to the home of the San Francisco Jewish leader, and he pretends to be a cowboy and kind of fails miserably at it. He can't really get the accent down. He doesn't have the chops to really be a cowboy. I wonder if that was in the back of your mind at all, or if that was just kind of an accidental reference. In my view, it's a reference to vaudeville.
No, I think...
I'm reading too deeply.
I don't know if that's in the original. If that's in the screenplay, I'm a little bit embarrassed. If it's not in the screenplay, I didn't write it. So I don't know. There's a problem where if you're writing a Jewish character and you're writing a kind of, he's got a kind of sarcastic wit, or he's got this, you have to be careful so that it doesn't fall into Jewish humor that's slightly, you know what I'm saying, disrespectful or whatever. But at the same time, there is a kind of Jewish wit and wisdom that pops, you know. And the Wilder, the rabbi, is that guy. I mean, when he says to, and I don't even know if it's in the movie, he says, you know, and he makes up stuff from the Talmud. He says, Talmud says, if you try to kill yourself three times on the fourth, you won't, we're not going to try to stop you. And later on, somebody says, that's in the Talmud? He says, nah, it's not really in there, but it applies, you know, I made it up. Why not? Right. So, yes, and of course, I mean, you know more about this than I do. The what's called Jew face, probably it's equivalent to blackface, and we've come a long way. The other thing that, and I don't think we were good at it, or we didn't show it in the movie, is, I mean, one of the contributions of the Jews in the Old West, the pioneer Jews, was the culture. You know, they built opera houses. They had theaters. They started newspapers. They had community groups. It was amazing what they did to enhance American culture in those godforsaken towns and cities. We didn't touch on that. I'm sorry, but if you read in the quarterly, you know, that comes through.
You get into that on the business side, right? Because there were contributions to the social atmospheres you're talking about, certainly with everything you mentioned, and, you know, libraries and social clubs and other things that Jews were at the forefront of instituting in these, you know, boom towns across the gold country, et cetera. Yeah. There are some scenes, though, and I should mention to all of us who are here, Michael has graciously allowed me to send around the original script from 1977, originally called No Knife, and maybe we'll get to that at some point, but I can send that to Aaliyah and she can forward it to everyone. It's really a wonderful treat because there are these scenes where Rabbi Avram actually encounters other Jews along the way. If you watch the movie, he's basically on his own. You know, he's the only Jew in the West. He's trying to figure out by himself. And I think he's made into more of a fool in the movie version than he really was in the script. As you mentioned, Michael, he's very wise in the original script. When he's on the ship, which is a whole scene that's cut from the beginning of the movie, where he gives this advice to a suicidal passenger on the ship that, you know, this kind of made up Talmudic wisdom, he shows himself to be a pretty adept and astute rabbinic figure, very contrary to how the film ends up portraying him, I think. But in the original script, on the kind of Jewish contribution side. The rabbi encounters a shopkeeper and he witnesses him running his business and doing business on Shabbat. And that's sort of like, what's going on here for Rabbi Avram? And the shopkeeper tells him, well, this is America. This is the way things have to be. You know, we have to understand that we can still wear our kippot and yet we have to adapt, right? There are a couple of little moments like that. I think another that takes place on a farm as well, where he encounters some other Jews. And there was this pattern of Jewish farming colonies in the Western regions of America around this time period as well. So I wonder if you can talk about that a little bit, Michael, the kind of vision of what the movie might have been in terms of presenting these unknown Jewish stories, right? Because I think part of it was to instill pride and pride of place among American Jews at this moment in time, 1979, when there was sort of a reawakening of Jewish ethnic identity in America following the other ethnic identity movements at that period, and kind of an energy to reclaim our ancestors and such. And kind of how the film ended up being without all of that kind of Jewish content, it ended up being a less Jewish movie, which might sound weird because it's one of the few kind of overtly Jewish movies that was made at that time. But nevertheless, it could have been even more Jewish and more accurate in a way than it was. And I wonder if you could just share a little bit about that.
Well, when we said to Gene, why did you take out these scenes with a shopkeeper who has to stay open on Saturday to survive, or wants to, or this Jewish farmer? He said, I'm the only Jew in the movie. I'm the Jewish hero. So, and what we wanted to show was again that overwhelming or important thing is that Jews were a part of the building of America and had a rightful place. And of course, you know, we were an immigrant population, but so was everybody else. And to do that, we wanted to show Gene on his way to San Francisco, meeting other Jews who were there before him and had established themselves. And there were Jewish farmers and there were Jewish shopkeepers and there were so forth, and Jewish traders. And that was really important to us, to show that, again, going back to what I said earlier, is that we wanted to, you know, as a kid, I wanted to see Jews in movies who weren't lawyers, judges, and loan sharks or whatever it was, whatever. And this was a way of doing it and making, and that was too bad that they were taken out.
Yeah. Can you speak a little bit about the atmosphere in Hollywood at the time and the uneasiness about making a Jewish movie?
Well, everybody said it's about time, but nobody wanted to make it. And it's a contradiction. I mean, I can say that everybody, people liked it and said, oh, you'll never get this made. Or I'm going to make it my personal mission to get this made, but it wasn't. Mike Nichols, if Mike Nichols had said, I'm going to do this, and he tried, I mean, he could have, there's no question about it. He could have gotten it made, but at the last minute he dropped out, but he wanted to do it. There is a part of me that wants to say that the Jews in the business, and I will never say the Jews run Hollywood, but the Jews in the business, the powerful ones, weren't that interested in making a movie about Jews and about a rabbi. So that's That's the way it was. It's interesting. I have another project, which is Anthony Burgess's novel about Christopher Marlowe, who was a great playwright and poet, contemporary of Shakespeare. And he's gay, and he's openly gay, and he's gay in a contemporary way, too, that he doesn't consider himself a freak. And this is Elizabethan England, where... And everybody says, this is great. We have a gay hero who's also violent. And he was a spy for the English secrets, blah, blah, blah. And everybody is telling me for the last 20 years, we're going to make this movie. And somehow it hasn't gotten made. And I think I'm back in Frisco Kid territory sometimes. But I mustn't let paranoia overtake me.
Yeah. No, this is a great segue for something I've been meaning to ask you, and I did ask you actually on the phone yesterday, and I will mention too, just very briefly, I think I forgot to, that there will be time for Q&A as well. I think we'll start that about 11:15. Aaliyah, you can take the questions maybe. Do you mind sharing how you want to do that, Aaliyah?
Yes, if you have a question, please message it to me in the chat and I will read it aloud.
Can I say something yeah. now, Jonathan? I know I sounds like I don't like the movie sometimes. There are things in it I don't like. There's a lot that I really like. And there's a lot of Gene Wilder that I really like. I mean, that scene of his determination and his the sunset scene is terrific. And it wouldn't have gotten made without him. And also... I know how people have told me how much they like it and how important it is, and that we did achieve our objective, which was to show a positive image of a Jew in the Old West and say to all the kids who are going to the movies, cowboy movies, hey, here's one for you. Right. And we're a part of this, and we're just as much as a part of this as anybody else. And that's really important, and I'm proud of it. And I know Frank is too, and Gene, and so forth. So my hat's off to them. I mean,
No, I totally understand the frustration of being a writer and in Hollywood. I know that the first vision is usually not the last vision, you know, as far as that goes. And
yeah,
you know that from the inside. I only know that from stories I hear from people like you, but I did want to just mention, since I see in the chat also someone mentioning reboot, and you talking about in the time when you originally made the film, even the Jews in Hollywood weren't so keen on making movies about themselves, if we can put it that way. Now there does seem to be a lot more energy around ethnically specific projects, certainly on streaming services. There are a lot of different programs now that are kind of niche in that way. And even specifically Jewish, you know, characters and programs, etc. And I mentioned to you yesterday, if you, or I asked really, if you'd ever thought about turning it into a series, maybe a short series, maybe several seasons of little stories, you know, taking the little scenes from both the movie and the original screenplay and turning it into episodes. You know, it's a very attractive idea to me as a historian of the Western states to see something like that. And I could certainly assist in any way that I might be able to. But, you know, just to see that on screen would be such a blessing, I think, for all of us.
I agree. And if anybody out there... as anybody, any relatives working at Netflix, let's go, or Amazon. Yeah, I think it's a great idea. And it strangely never occurred to me. At one point I told you there was a movement about at some point to turn it into a musical. And that made sense too. But I think it would absolutely be a good streamer or 8 episodes, or even, you know, you can keep going for years. It takes a long time to go across the country, and you have him, you know, stopping here, and you know that the scene where he goes to the there's a scene in the movie, but is not the same as a scene in the screenplay where he is on a working with other immigrants, a Chinese guy and an Italian guy, and they're building stuff. And that could be a real episode too. So
yeah, I think it would really get to the heart, I think, again, of the story, not only the Jewish experience, the pioneer experience in the West, but also the multi-ethnic experience of that era. Jews certainly interacting with all kinds of other people, many of whom were new to the land as well, also the natives of the land. There's so much, I think, that is very present and current.
Yeah.
Even show
wouldn't it be great for him to come across the Mexican, Jews in Mexico or, conversos, and then find out that, that's here I am.
To be honest, I think our country needs those kinds of stories these days.
Absolutely.
Yeah. And just before we get to the Q&A, this has been wonderful, and I feel like we could talk probably forever, but we have time constraints. Tell us a little bit about that musical that you were alluding to. I know that it had kind of an interesting premise, if you want to share.
Oh, well, yeah, I wrote a scenario, I guess, for the musical, which would be that it would take place in the 20s, and the rabbi would be 90 years old, and so would his Tommy Lillard would have been at one point governor of California, he's now retired emeritus of a huge big San Francisco congregation. They have a big synagogue, and they also have a big community center, and they have a theater, and the kids in the theater are going to do a pageant about the life of the rabbi and how he came to America and how he came across the country. And it's based on everything he told them. And of course, it's all lies because he perfumed everything. The night before, in the middle of the rehearsal, he gets sick and he pleads with God for, give me another 2 weeks so I don't spoil the performance. And God tells him, okay, but you got to tell the truth. And he goes down and he rewrites his journey and tells the truth. And so it's mixed. Anyway, that was the idea. And it's put on by the local, by his theater company. But maybe somebody will find a way to do that.
That is brilliant. And I'm thinking that would even be a great final episode of the streamer, to have kind of that scenario.
Yeah.
Anyway, all really wonderful. Again, if you haven't seen the movie, I hope now you're interested in seeing it. If you've seen it before, I hope that this provides some context for it, maybe for your repeat viewing that you'll be having, I'm sure, as soon as we finish today. Yeah, go ahead.
Can I make a pitch for my novel?
Yeah, I was about to do that before.
Oh, okay.
But yeah.
You can hold up a con. It's called You Can Go Home Now, and it's a thriller. And it's about a young cop in Queens who is, and when it alludes to her dark past, what her past is, her father was an abortion provider who was murdered by an anti-abortion terrorist. And she's looking for him. At the same time, she's working undercover in a battered women's shelter. Because there may be a connection between some murders outside the shelter of abusive men. And the two stories come together. So it's very contemporary because it's about anti-abortion terrorism and what we're facing now. And it's called You Can Go Home Now. And you can buy it at Amazon or online, whatever. Okay, I'm done.
Great. Thank you. And you mentioned that you're working on another novel as well.
I just finished about it's kind of my life in Hollywood fictionalized so I can tell the truth. And it's about a writer in the 70s and 80s. Pretty pretty kind of funny, and it's also pretty political because he's also involved in the anti-war movement in the Weather Underground, and his wife is involved, and it's got that. Well, at the same time, he's writing sitcoms for Norman Lear. So that's called Bender Sees the Elephant, that's and other stuff, but that's what I'm doing.
One of the things I really appreciate about all of your work that I've enjoyed over the years is how politically, socially astute it really is. You don't sort of hide behind the comedy. Everything, you know, the social topics are there, and I think as Jewish leaders in training, I think this is a wonderful way to look at different ways that Jewish contributors can impact society. Certainly, all of us in our roles as Jewish communal leaders, we can take a page out of your book, be entertaining, but also be very current and try to move people in positive directions. I think there are many ways that we can do that. And, you know, Michael, for a lot of us, you're something of a rabbi. So I appreciate that. And with that, I don't need you to comment on that. But Aaliyah, why don't you ask
some questions? Our first question, was it important to you or essential that there was a Jewish man cast in the role of the rabbi?
It didn't. I don't think it came up. I really don't think it was. The actors, there was Dustin Hoffman, Gene Wilder. I think at one point De Niro was considered. So I don't think anybody said this guy has to be Jewish. It's different now. But and by the way, Harrison Ford came out as Jewish during the filming of the movie. Did you know that? Anyway.
That's great. That's amazing.
All right.
What has been, during your career, your most challenging experience or your biggest learning?
My biggest learning? I'm not sure. I think writing so many different... being interested in so many different things, which is kind of not actually been good for my career. I've been interested in too many things. Science fiction, Indian, Inca, civilization, Elizabethan writers. It just, so I would, I don't know, what I love about writing and writing about what I don't know is finding out. It's like going back to school each time, going back and finding out what America was like in 1850, and finding out what Inca life was, finding out what Elizabethan. So, for me, writing is learning, and they're synonymous. Okay.
Next question. One thing that this person really admires about the movie is how it doesn't play on stereotypes, especially regarding Chinese, Hispanic, and Native American characters. Was there pressure to make those minor characters more stereotypical?
No. No. And one of my favorite characters in the movie is, well, I don't know if he is even in the movie, but certainly in the original screenplay, is in the Indian encampment, is a escaped slave. That's true. There were escaped slaves who went in, became Indians. They were accepted into Indian tribes, and he's one of my favorite characters.
In the script only, and again, we'll make that available. One of the more intriguing characters from my perspective also.
Yeah, I have to say that you will, in the movie, when Gene Wilder goes into the Indian camp to retrieve the Torah, he manages to get tortured, and because of his, am I right, Jonathan? Because of his bravery, the Indians come to respect him as he's being tortured for the Torah. In the screenplay, he goes in, and it's all a negotiation where he, nobody wants to torture him. They just want to know why this Torah book is so important to him. And he says, because it contains my God and my religion and everything. And they say, where he gets the Torah back, but he leaves the covering for the child. To wear, and that they give a new cover to the Torah, which has feathers on it, and it's leather, and it becomes an American Torah, and that was a really important thing in the screenplay, the Americanization of the Torah. It even has a little piece of gold, some gold nuggets on it. Anyway, so if you do read the screenplay, you will see that part. That's one of my favorites. Go ahead.
Some people are in the process of writing their graduate theses for our school, and others write music or creative liturgy. Can you share a little bit about your writing process?
I try to avoid it as much as possible. until my day is to do as many errands as I can until there's nothing left to do. That means I have to write. I'm not... although now I think maybe as I'm older, my time is more precious, but I've always found it difficult. So maybe having, oh, am I supposed to give it? That's how I write. I'm not one to come for advice about writing. It's too hard. It's hard, but then there's that real contradiction about, because I say to a writer, well, I can, it's hard for me to sit down and write. And I said, what gives you the most pleasure in life? Writing? Why do you avoid it so much? It's a puzzlement, as they say. Okay.
Have you ever experienced or witnessed anti-Semitism or racism in Hollywood? And if so, what happened and what did you do or not do?
No, I'll tell you a thing I did once with a writer, Diana Gould. There was a blood drive. The Writers Guild used to have a blood drive in association with a group called the Vikings, I think they were. And you got if you donated blood, you went to a restaurant called Scandia, which was like a really big hot restaurant in those days. And you donated your blood, and you were given a free lunch, which was pretty good deal. So they sent out a letter saying, by the way, you know, this, in the invitation, and at the bottom it said, by the way, this is only, it's only men, because it's a men, it's only men, only men are allowed to do this, because it's a men's club. So we wrote a letter, which was exactly the same, but wherever it said men, we said Jews. And we took the letter, and we went to a Writers Guild meeting and said, hey, we got this letter that says from the Vikings saying you can donate blood, but only if you're a Christian. You cannot know, if you're Jewish, you can't, because it's a Christian club. And they went, what? This is outrageous. This is terrible. We're canceling, blah, blah, blah. And we said, no, this is the letter you wrote, but you said no women, and we put in no Jews. And that's not fine. Anyway, the Writers Guild, they changed the thing. So, okay, and aside from Mel Gibson, no, I don't, I mean, that was public. I don't like it when, I consider it anti-Semitic when people say Jews run Hollywood. I can say that, I mean, no. But I think my time in Hollywood has been free of anti-Semitism, because it just has. Have I answered that? Hello?
Yes.
Okay.
Aaliyah, do I have time to introduce one?
Yes.
Okay,
go
great.
Go for it.
I see that Rabbi Steve Robbins is with us. You may not know Rabbi Robbins, Michael, but he was a religion consultant for the film, The Frisco Kid. And I think it's just great for you to meet each other.
Hello, Michael.
Hey, how you doing?
Nice to meet you finally.
Yeah, yeah, I read a lot about you. I mean, I would read your, your interviews, I think.
You mean about my near-death experiences?
No, about your contribution to the film.
To the film. Yeah, I got involved because Mason Neufeld called the synagogue he belonged to, where I was a rabbi, and he asked me if I knew anything about Jews in the West. And my master's thesis on assimilation and immigration included a whole chapter on Jews in the West, because I grew up in Utah, Arizona, Nevada, et cetera, because of my dad's business. And I was adopted as a Navajo when I was 18. So I had a lot of experience, and I thoroughly applaud everything that you said about the movie. It clearly was much of a disappointment. I was there for the shooting of a lot of the scenes, and Gene was like a wild horse that he had to keep pulling the reins on. And frequently I had Bob Aldrich on one rein and I was on the other. And I said to him, if you don't stop it, I'm gonna sew your circumcision back on. But he finally agreed to a number of things. The tallit that was in that scene, that I have that tallit, it originally was used by Al Jolson in The Jazz Singer.
Wow.
And it belonged to his father, the cantor. And when the film ended, they gave it to me along with a couple of other things. But it was a great experience. And what my experience was the same as yours. There were so many of those rich scenes about the development of Avram and the well of his empathic persona, his wisdom that comes out, that helps Jews and shows their process moving, that Gene cut some of it out and Warner's cut some of it out. So as they kept saying, it's too Jewish. And between the two, they really gelded a good part of it. And it was sad that we got stuck with what we did, but what we did came out the best that we could get everybody to put it together. There were many times I went to Mace Neufeld, who had remained a friend up until his death this year. And I said, Mace, the scenes are there, re-edit them, let's re-release it. And he just didn't have the koach to do it. And that's why when Jonathan said we should redo The Frisco Kid as a series, I said, let's do it. And we could really show that transition and the Americanization of the Jewish immigrant and the Jewishization of America.
Yeah, very good point.
Absolutely. Well said. Well said. I didn't know about the tension between that. I didn't know about the stuff that was going on. I really didn't. Once they started filming, we really didn't have much to do with it.
The scene of his adoption was based upon the ceremony I went through for my adoption. So there were some real parallels that I was able to share. And at the same time, the capote that he wears under the chuppah, we got from Velvel Pasternak, who went to the Hasidim on the Lower East Side and got it. And they couldn't believe that it was going to be made in a movie. So there were lots of just side pieces, which were really exciting. The breastplate from the Torah that is stolen, that Gene gets back, is based on the one we had in Emmanuel, and the Torah that they opened was photographed from one of our scrolls in the synagogue. So there were a lot of places that I was able to try and keep it contained and keep it within some Jewish content. And it was very difficult. That scene at the door with Penny Pizer, with Gene playing the cowboy from the Texas, was really embarrassing, because if you look at the mezuzah that's on the door, it's pointing the wrong way, and I couldn't get it to change it because it would leave holes in the door jamb. So there were a variety of issues like that that were really part of what was hysterical about making the movie.
Yeah.
Well, yeah. I hope that you two are able to talk further. And thank you so much, Steve. We've talked quite a bit about the film as well, the two of us.
One other comment. I also had a hand in making The Prince of Egypt, so we might do that another time.
Oh, that would be great. Okay. Absolutely.
Make sure, yeah, Jonathan, make sure. And by the way, everybody's, you can provide my email address to everybody, and I'll enter into correspondence and answer any questions or whatever, or accept any compliments or brickbats that anybody has. Yeah.
I appreciate that.
Yeah.
I know we're running a little short on time. I think there was a good point made by one of our students in terms of, you know, that was, and I think, Steve, you mentioned it as well. Maybe it was the best version of that movie that could have been made at that particular time. Not the best version of that movie that was possible in general. And, you know, for those of us who grew up with it, myself included, I think it did work. You know, it worked to kind of instill an image of Jews in the West. You know, it didn't seem so fantastical. I think it was a source of pride. is very much a beloved movie for those reasons. It does show us that our American roots are deeper than maybe our family, immediate family histories, most of us. So it is loved for the right reasons, but I think at the same time, it's time to make a better version. Let's do it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Amen.
That's great. Thank you. That's great. Yeah.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah.
Thank
one last thing, Aliyah. I'm sorry.
Yes.
Thank you so much, Michael. So I'm going to be sending around the script. Thank you again for allowing us to do that. Can you tell us a bit about the name that may be confusing to some? Originally, No Knife ends up being the Frisco Kid. What does No Knife mean?
Oh, when he is in the conference with the Indian chief about trying to get his Torah back, he says, "Well, what will you give me for this Torah?" He doesn't really say the word, and he says, "Will you give me your horse?" He says, "Yes." "Will you give me your clothes?" "Yes." I mean, "Will you give me all your money?" "Yes." "Will you give me your knife?" And the rabbi says, "I have no knife." And they go, "No knife?" And then later, Gene is in a bar, and he says, they say, you know, "What's your name?" or something like that. And he says, "No knife." So we thought that would be a good title.
Yeah.
No knife. Okay.
Well, thank you for sharing that. And thank you so much for your time and for being with us.